Hi friends, welcome to my channel. Please subscribe to my channel. I think the technology videos I'm adding is useful for you too, useful for the people. And thanks for the people who is commenting your queries or the support in the comment box. Thank you so much. You can point out what are the mistake I'm doing. So I'm happy to learn from each and everyone. So okay, let us continue our topic on Python fundamentals. So last video we saw Python data types and data structure. So in this video I will continue other concepts in the Python fundamentals. So next thing I want to discuss is if statement, else statement, elif statement. And what is the there is no switch case supported in the Python, so we have alternate way to do that. So we'll see how we can do that. So example, I create a variable called integer variable 8. I'm checking if the count value is 10, I want to print a string as number is 10. So if does not match this, it will not execute this. Okay. So similarly, I created a boolean variable called isAllow. So I set that value as true. So if the value is true, I will want to print I am allowed. So if I set a value as false, this is for these two examples for if, okay, for positive and negative scenario. So again, this example for if else. So I created a isAllowed variable as false. So I am checking if actually I need not to again compare with value equal to true. And I say if of boolean variable, then if it is a true, it will go inside. If it is a false, it will come to the else part. So else part can be defined using the else keyword. So if it is a true, it will say it will print I am allowed. Otherwise I am not allowed, it will print I am not allowed. So elif is when it will be used is, say the first example we checked count is 10, but if it is not a 10, it will not go inside. But I can make elif is nothing but else if of count equal to 8, I want to print number 8. So that I can make use of both if block and else if block called elif. Okay, so print of in single quote doubles single quote slash n means it's a new line. I'm creating a new line character just for readability purpose. Then I said the switch is not there in the Python, right? Switch case. So how we can find a switch cases or do the alternative way for implementing switch cases? You can create a dictionary. Okay, so I'm creating a dictionary called switch here, where I say key equal to key colon value. Okay, so key value pair I'm creating. So when I actually find out the value for a particular key, so I can pass right a switcher is a dictionary dot get of number, whatever number input I am getting, if I pass I get the key value for that. So that's how the key case statement works, right? So generally it will have for default statement that I am putting here. So if none of these matching, then it will return nothing. So this way you can actually, so sorry for the interruption. So so we defined the switch case using the dictionary. I created it as a function. Okay, so I think we did not see what is a function, so I will see in the details section. So basically function is defined using def keyword and followed by the function name, and you can have parameterized. Previously I said, right, it can have argument or one argument or multiple, or it can have without argument also a function can be created. So function generally will have a return statement, or it can have without return statement also. So in the function we created the dictionary, and then in the return statement we say dictionary.get of whatever the value input is passed, that will be considered as key, and matching key for the respective value will be shown, or otherwise nothing. So I assigned number as 2 and I call this function by passing 2. If I matched, if I number will be passed, so there is a 2 key value called 2, then it will get the number is 2. Then I pass number as 3, that time it will say nothing because there is no number 3 for the key. So I am executing this. So first it says I am allowed, means this statement is executed, this is passed actually. So after that it says not allowed because it is false. It will, if it is a true only, it will go inside, it will come to not false. So here number is count is 8, so it will execute this block, number is 8. In switch case, first statement we passed 2, so it is written number is 2, but second scenario is we passed 3, so there is no key value called 3, so it returns nothing. So this is how we can implement if else statements and switch cases. So next important thing I want to discuss is loop statement. Okay, two loop statements there in the Python. One is for and another is while. So for loop is used to iterate over the sequence. Sequence is nothing but a list of values, right? List of elements. So I create a list. So you can also create a list using list keyword, and followed by you need to pass the sequence of numbers basically. So this is a list. So you create, it will create a mark list. I want to iterate this list using for loop. So the command is our syntax is for mark in marks list. So basically a mark is nothing but a one element. So take each element from the mark list and print it. That's what this statement does. So you see, that's what this does. This is the example of a for loop. So you can do a lot of stuff using for loop. The next is while loop. While loop is nothing but it is used to iterate over the block of code as long as the particular given condition is satisfied. Okay, condition or expression is satisfied. What I am doing here is I am setting count value as 0. Count is less than 10, and inside the while loop I am actually having a block of code. What I am doing is I am just incrementing the count value and printing it. So until the count value is less than 10, the while loop will get executed. Afterwards it will break and come out. So I execute this. So you see, till 10 it has executed, after that it came out. That's the use of while loop. Okay. So next is control statements. So basically if you have a loop, whether you want to break the loop, or if you want to break the continuous particular iteration in the loop, instead of breaking entire loop, you just want to skip that iteration. So there are particular keywords available, using that you can do it. Okay, so one is the keyword called break, which will actually break entire loop. So I am actually, there is a range keyword which will create a range of 10 numbers from 10 numbers, okay, from 0 to 9. 10 is exclusive. Okay, so 0 to 9 it will generate. So I am printing, if it is a 3, I will break the loop. So for that is the use of break. It will break the entire loop. After 3 it will not print anything. But in the next test for loop, I am generating same sequence of numbers from 1. I am starting from 1 to 10. Why I mentioned 11 is 11 is a exclusive. So I want to print only the even numbers. So if it is even number, I'll say number is even. It's like I mod 2, if it returns the remainder as 0, then it is even number. I'll print a number is even. Otherwise, I'll say skipping print. So skipping current iteration. Okay, so basically it will say, example, after this we have some print statement, so that we will understand. So I, okay, so if you will see only this I value for only even numbers, you will not see for the odd numbers. Pass is nothing but basically it will just it will execute it, it will not be any effect for the pass. Basically when you have when pass is used is pass keyword, when you have unimplemented logic in your code, so instead of just commenting out entire the block, you can just say pass in that block, so that it will just get executed, but it will not do any evaluation, which means it will not get executed. Means it will execute, but it will not give any effect. Okay, so if you don't give in this if statement, if you don't give this pass, it will say it's syntax error, because if block you should have some statement, right? So when you have unimplemented block of code, then you can use pass. So I just print execute this. So first, when using break, it is actually broken when reached the value as 3, which we gave break. But when use count, so it is actually printed only even numbers. When it comes odd number, it is break the that particular iteration. Okay, so there is no effect in the pass, so that's what we see. So next next the topic we want to see is functions. This is one of the important topic in the Python fundamentals. So function, so basically function is why we create function is for reusability. So you can create a block of code and create a give name for that, and the block of code will do some kind of a computation, or it can be a simple display. Then you can use it in the further programming programs. So there are two types: inbuilt functions and user defined functions. Inbuilt functions, already there are functions which is already there in the Python. So like length is one of the function which will return you the number of elements in the list. So in this example, I given a list with the 5 values, so it will be length of 5. So there is a function called min, it will find out the minimum value from this list. Similarly max, and there is your sum, which will return the sum from this list. So we know type, there is a function called type which will return the type of the variable or the value. So that's what we are doing it here. So it return list of 5 values, then this is the length of the list, minimum value in the list, maximum value in the list, sum from the values in the list. So initially when I assign 10, it has become an integer value, then I converted. There is a function called str, okay, to convert from basically the from integer value to so any type into string value. That's what it does. Okay, so next we will see user defined functions. Okay, so user defined function, as I told you, function can be defined using the def keyword followed by def function name, and it can have it should have open and close bracket. So but argument, it can have one argument, or it can have without argument also. Function can have without argument also. And it can have return statement, or it may not have return. So if return is not there, it will actually return as none. The function will return as none. So in this function, it is going to return, it is going to print the allow Python, but it will return the value as none. Similarly, this function I am actually passing the, instead of passing the directly value, I am passing the variable. So what are the variable assigned to that, what are the value assigned to that variable, that will get printed, but still it, there is no return statement, so it will return none. So again I created one more method called add number. So I'll say numbers. Okay, so def number. Python is the main thing is indentation is important. In other programming language like Java, so use the open curly braces, close curly braces between the block of code, right? Or function definition, class definition. Here we use colon followed by the indentation. So you need to give one tab of space here. Okay, so when I execute this, so first it is printed allow Python, then the function display, then the next function display message, it is displayed what are the message I passed to that variable, but still it returned none. The third is we passed it two values and 3 and 5, so it is added 5 and 3 and returned value as 8. So this is how you can create a functions. So next thing is, so we all till now we saw we assigned value in the program and then we do the lot of manipulation that. But if you want to get user input, is there any way? Yes, there is a way. There is a function called input which actually takes the input from the user. So when I execute this, it will ask the user input. It will get assigned to the particular variable. I'm just printing that variable and type of that variable also. I execute this. So it is asking please enter the amount. I say 10.5. Okay, just enter. It's a floating number because it has decimal value. That's all. So next important concepts. Next in some important concept of Python fundamentals, file handling. So any programming you will take, you have IO operations. Okay, so I am going to tell you three important file handling mechanism. One is reading and writing a file, text file, and then reading writing a CSV file and reading writing a JSON file. So to read a file, text file, there is a function called open. If you pass a particular file including path and mode as read, it will give you a reader object. From that you can read the lines. So there is a text file in my folder. I have a Hadoop as one text file which contains a definition of Hadoop, and I have a CSV file, which CSV file generally comma separator. So I have header columns, name, ID, name, city, and three values, so three rows of value for that. Okay, so then I have another file, okay, which is a JSON file. JSON file will always be a key value pair. So basically I have a name Bob and the language he speaks is English and French. So there was a typo. So these are the three files I have, okay. So let us go back here. So I'm going to read the text file. I'm going to print all the lines from the text file. So it does that. So if you want to write the if you want to get a text file and add some piece of information to that file, so using the open function you give the file name and with the write mode. Okay, so then you get a the file object. Using the write method you pass the value. So for the line delimiter I am using particular text and followed by slash n, which will give a new line. Then after that I will close the file up. So if I run this, it will create a file name called sample_file.txt. It will have two lines of content. Yes, it has. So next file handling technique we want to see is CSV file. So for CSV file, we need to import the package called CSV. There are two important concepts in Python. One is a module, another is package. Module is nothing but, again, it's a set of Python statement. So Python file which contains set of statements. So then you can import, using import command, you can import the module and you can use it. So basically reusable code can be created as a module and you can use it. Package is nothing but it's a namespace, you can call it as. Basically it's a dictionary, it's a folder which will have sub packages and modules. With that there should be a file called __ init, where it can have initialization. So that you can call it as package. So you can, so there are a lot of inbuilt packages available in Python. You just import and you can use it. So there is one of the packages called CSV to do the CSV file manipulation. That's what you are importing here. So the file actually, reading, I showed you already the people.csv. So use the open again, give the read mode, it will give you the CSV file object. Using the csv.reader, you pass the file object, it will give the reader. So then you can use a for loop to read each line. That's what I am doing it here. So it will read the each line from the CSV file and it displays. To write it again, you need to open a file, means you are creating a file, people_new, and mode as WB. So mode as actually write you can give, but what happens is when you give only W, write mode, it introduces blank lines for every lines. So I just googled it, there is another option called WB, which will not introduce any blank lines. So that's why I use WB here. So I create a file name called people_new.csv in the write mode. I get the CSV file object. Using the writer method, csv.writer method, I can give the file object, and I want to use the delimiter as comma separator. So I just pass a list to this write row method. So each value will be comma separated and written into the CSV file. So I am passing first is header field and then followed by the same whatever row value you want to insert. Sorry for the interruption. So if you run, already ran I guess. If you come and see, there will be a person and a people_new, so which will log the value which we wrote. This is a CSV file write operation. So next we want to see is the JSON file handling. Okay, so there are again, writing JSON file, use the package called JSON. Using the again, open the JSON file with and then using the JSON as function called load, it will load the entire content from the JSON file and it will display using the print command. Okay, so if you want to write it again, same value I want to write it as a JSON file. So including other, I'm adding a few more. So basically you can create a dictionary, okay, and then you pass the dictionary to the dump function. Okay, so it will create what are the values in the dictionary to the JSON file. So when I execute this, so if you go and check in the person new j.json, you will find the dictionary value being written here. You have two more properties like age and married, true or false. Okay, so that's all about Python, sorry, JSON read and write. Then most important concepts I want to discuss in Python is object-oriented support. So object-oriented means you actually implement your code in in terms of real world objects. So you have a class object inheritance. There are three concepts at least in Python it is we can implement. There are many more object oriented concepts like abstraction, encapsulation, so and so, polymorphism. So we'll see what is class. So classes are foundation of object oriented programming. Class represent real world things you want to model in your program. Example, employees, cars, banks. Okay, so a class defines a general behavior of the broad category of objects can have and information that has been associated with those programs. So class will have properties and functions. Okay, so this is the example of class. So I have a class called user. So user can have ID, name, so and so, right? Email address, phone number, other stuff. So I created only one property. So it has user. So you see there is a special function called underscore underscore init underscore underscore followed by self comma name. This is called constructor. So constructor is a special function which will get called while creating an object for this class. So basically it is for initialization. So if we pass name, so self is nothing but this keyword in Java, if you are people are familiar with Java. So value field I am assigning with the name which is getting initialized, and there is a method called print name. I am just printing the name whatever it got set in the name property. This is the definition of class. So we are defining class. Object is the instance of your class. So if you create a user, so then if I want to create a user for Karthik, so I can create, I need to create an object for the Karthik. So create a object, you just say class name. If you have a parameterized constructor, then you pass the parameter. If it is non-parameterized, you just say user of open close bracket. So we have a parameter name, so that's what we pass as Karthik. So it will have a user object. User object. So if you just say call the print method, it will print the name which you passed. So I just create this and run this. So that's what it is. It is written a name for that object. Name for the object user. Object of user. Okay, so next concept we want to discuss is inheritance. Okay, inheritance is nothing but actually inheritance gives capability of one class to derive and inherit properties from another class. Basically, if you have a class, you want to acquire or inherit from some properties from that class, you can do using inheritance. So basically, the class from which you are inheriting is become base class. The class which you are actually inherited, which is a derived class or subclass. So in the previous example, we have a user, right? So if user is the base class or the parent class, you have a print method. So you can create a subclass by inheriting user, and you can make use of these properties and function. Also, you can do you can create additional functionality in the base class. So I am having the same init method. So every class you can have will have a constructor. So I am actually same name is also assigned. So it will get assigned to the programmer name. Okay, and I have apart from print function, I have a print function. It will get derived from the base class. So in this subclass, I have a function called doPython. which will print some string here. So if I create a object for user, okay, so it actually create the object for user, and we can actually only use this print method because we have only defined print method, so it print our own. But if you create an object for programmer, actually it is inheriting some of the properties, all the properties from the user class. So it will have, apart from print class, we'll have a do Python method also. But from print method, print name method for function, you have a do Python function also. So if you execute this, so from the user object, it is printed name as Arun. From the programmer object, it printed name as Vijay, and also print method is we are using users print method. And apart from that, we have a do function, do Python function, which is printing the program in Python. I hope this video is useful. Please subscribe to my channel to get more technology videos. We'll see, these are the basically main concepts in the Python fundamentals. We have a lot of packages in Python to learn more things about Python. So we have a Python for numerical computation like NumPy, SciPy, for data like kind of table operation you want to do, data frame operation, you have pandas. For visualization, you have matplotlib, and there are other third party libraries like seaborn, plotly, other stuff. So whenever I get free, I'll do videos on those two. But these two videos are basically enough for the to know Python fundamentals. Thank you so much, friends. Please subscribe to my channel to get more technology videos. Thank you so much.